is NDTV. And you're watching NDTV Prime. Welcome to the Realty Debate. As the clock strikes 12 at midnight, the biggest tax reform undertaken in independent India, the Goods and Services Tax, GST, will roll out. With the message of one nation, one tax, the government is ready to make GST live during a special session in Parliament. But GST is also giving jitters to many. One such sector is the real estate sector. Today on Realty Debate, we discuss how GST will impact the sector and the end user. For this, we are joined by some leading voices of the real estate sector. We have with us Anuj Puri. He's Chairman, Anarock Property Consultants. We also have Rohit Raj Modi, Director, Ashiana Homes, and Secretary, CREDAI. We also are joined by Rajesh Prajapati, Managing Director, Prajapati Group, and also Prashant Bhatt, Partner, BMR and Associates. Welcome to the show, gentlemen. Let's begin with you, Rohit. Because we are talking about a new tax regime, everybody, especially the buyers, are hoping, because that is the message we are getting from the government, that now things are going to be a lot cheaper for the end user. So are the builders ready to give that benefit, which we are assuming you're going to get? Are you going to give it forward, pay it forward?
Absolutely. You see, any input credit which the developers are going to get in the running projects would get passed on to the consumer. The issue is that, in media we are talking in very simplified manner about, prices coming down by X percent or Y percent. But the quantum of the benefit being passed on depends upon every project and is unique to every project, even in a developer's portfolio, depending upon at what stage of construction is that particular project is in. Because unlike most of the other manufacturing goods, you could take an example of a soap or a shampoo or a car, where the production cycle is as small as 2 days to maybe 1 month long. In construction, it's about 5 years long. And like every other goods, we have been told that the input credit would be available only for last 12 months period. Now, projects which have already completed the superstructure 2 years back and have consumed all the steel and the cement that they had to, they would have very little to pass on. Whereas projects which are in the earlier part of the construction, they would have more to pass on. So it would vary from project to project. But having said that, any input benefit that would accrue will be passed on.
Okay. So that's one good thing that we are hearing from you, and that is that you will, any input credit that you accrue, you will hand over to the buyer. But Anuj, let's begin with you about this. This is quite a genuine concern. You know, the product cycle is sometimes more than 3 years, 5 years, or even more. Now, will this divide the market for the user into this, I will get certain benefits in, but just because this person's house started getting constructed in a certain era, a year, he's not going to get certain benefits. Is GST going to bring a divide?
Very interesting, Anjali, and I appreciate the question that you are asking, and likewise Rohit's point. But clearly, in my opinion, there are too many variables at this moment in time for the GST. It is a very good tax that the government is bringing in. It's going to definitely bring in transparency and bring a lot of accountability. But the trouble is, as Rohit is saying, is that there is going to be an input credit that he is going to pass it on to the consumer. My understanding is that it's going to be very difficult initially to find out what is that input credit that they're going to be able to secure from the small contractors who are working for the developers and may not be GST registered today. So clearly that evolution is going to take some time for those contractors where you know, it's either a labor contract or a separate goods contract that you're giving, and those small contractor would just not be registered under GST, and hence you're not going to be able to take the input credit. And if you're not going to get the input credit, you're not going to be able to pass it to the consumer, that input credit. So I think is that give it 18 months for it to really go through and for the water to find its own course, and then you're going to be able to find what really is the benefit that the consumer is getting. I dare say, Anjali, that today you speak with any developer who's going to be able to tell you is whether the prices are going to go up or prices are going to come down with the influence of the GST. I've met up with all the developers, not all the developers, but majority of the developers, and I can tell you they're like, you know, Anuj, I don't know. I'm going to, you know, over the next few months, next few quarters, really understand whether this is going to increase the price, decrease the price. But as Rohit said, is everybody is saying is if there is an input credit that we are going to get, we're 100% going to pass it on to the consumer, and that is as per law. But I think the big four accounting firms at this moment in time are very busy to be able to understand that what that input credit each of the developer is going to secure in their own business.
Absolutely. Rajesh, do you agree with the fact that there are a lot of gaping holes in this entire mathematics, and that you will spend a lot of time just, you know, right now filling in a lot of blanks?
Yeah, I'm sure there is a lot of variables, like Anuj said, and a lot of calculations have to be done. Like, there is a provision in which they are saying that the input tax credit will be given on semi-finished goods. Now, does that mean that if the cement is converted into cubes, then we will get input tax credit? But if the cement is converted into mortar and is used for filling up the columns or beams or slab, then we will not get input credit. Or work in progress will not result in us getting input credit on the steel purchased for doing that work. So it's lot of variables now, and there are certain things which are not very clear. So only going ahead a few months will actually come to know whether we'll be really getting some input tax credits. As I was just speaking to Anuj, many of the builders, most of the builders, I could say, our developers do not actually know what the scene will be like, of going ahead a few months.
Absolutely. I can sort of understand that. Now, Prashant, for any product to understand that how effective it is, and here a system, you have to bring it to the ground and actually start using it, and that's when you know what's wrong with it, what's the good part of it. Now, here, what kind of problems do you really foresee for the developers and the end users as well? Because a lot of people are writing to us and are saying, we've heard that the prices are going to come down, but my developer is saying this, my developer is telling me to pay up front right now so that your taxation cost comes down. What do you feel? What have you foreseen?
I agree, Anjali, the expectations have gone up. I think that's the, and meeting those expectations is a challenge for the developer community, because like I endorsed the panelists' views, because when do you realize that you're actually gaining and the construction costs are coming down? Because it's while we talk about input credits, it's actually construction costs undertaken after 1st July under the GST regime coming down. So when do you realize this? When do you get to quantify this? So that's the whole debate that's going on. So for the developer community, what we are looking at is the dilemma is it's all projection based. They are in turn dependent on their contractors, and some of these are big contractors. So those contractors have to pass on the benefits to the developer in terms of reduced construction cost, which then the developer can pass on to the customer. Otherwise, developer is looking at a scenario where the expectation from the customers are to be met, but then there's no commensurate benefits from the contractor side. So effectively, so if you look at a north market, you're looking at today 4.5% service tax plus 1% VAT, 5.5% is a tax on a flat. It's going up to 12%. Okay, and if say 40% of your installments are paid and 60% is due. So you're actually looking at the contractor construction cost coming down by around 7%, and to realize that, it's a negotiation. It's how hard the developers negotiate. It's a willingness of the chain, the entire ecosystem, because the contractors in turn will be dependent on the steel and cement guys. So the entire ecosystem to understand and to factor the benefits of GST, and in turn after that getting passed on to the customer will take some time. So we're also looking at talking to developers, and developers are saying, can we pass this on, quantify this at the end of the completion of the project? I will wait, I will not do anything in haste today. I will wait, I will charge the same amount of taxes. If I am collecting 5.5% taxes, I'll collect the same amount of taxes today and gross up and back work and pay GST. But if there's any reduction to be achieved, I will estimate it at the time of the completion. Can I pass on to the customers then?
Okay.
I think that's what the developers are looking at. I think from a customer side, I think we'll have to be a little more patient. The developer community, like the panelists have endorsed, is looking at passing on the benefits. It's the timing of how much and when.
Okay, so that's quite a prudent advice, especially for developers. But you know, I want to get back to you because the consumer side that you're saying. But when you were talking about construction and payment cost ratio, is there any percentage that we can come to that if your construction is done up to this percentage, maybe it's good for you to not prepay, and if it's up to this percentage, maybe it's good for you to pay. Is it possible or it's completely not possible?
I don't think it's possible, Anjali, because I don't think if you just prepay by June 30, you'll be absolved from any GST liabilities, because the transition provisions contained in the law are very clear.
Okay.
What they're saying is, to the extent of work that the developer has done till date, okay, the existing taxes apply. And in my example, 40% work is done. So on the 40%, the existing taxes apply.
Okay.
On the 60%, which is done under GST, only GST applies.
Okay.
So I don't think the customer, by prepaying the remaining installments, will get away from any increased taxes under GST, which is unlikely, because we are actually looking at the EMIs, the installments coming down by way of discounts. But I don't think that prepaying now, and getting away from GST is an option.
Now, this is an interesting observation from you. I would like to ask you, Rohit, about this, because a lot of people, a lot of developers from your community have sent out these emails, mailers, talked to the customers and told them to prepay. Now, do you have a different take on this?
No, I agree with what Prashant just said, because law, to my mind, is very clear that you cannot ask for a payment for a stage which has not become due. Even if a developer takes an advance, what is an advance? Advance is a payment for a stage or a service which has not been rendered. So if a payment has been received for a stage which has not arrived, then on that advance, even you will post 1st July, you will have to pay GST after subtracting whatever service tax has been paid on that. Whether there would be any kind of a prosecutionary behavior on that I don't know. But it is very clear that an advance for a service not rendered does not absolve you from the responsibility of paying GST. But Anjali, can I take your attention to a most important point as far as real estate and GST is concerned, if you permit? You see, there is no abatement of land cost in the 12% GST that has been offered. There has been this talk that it is embedded in it, but how this impacts the pricing is an important thing for us to understand. The cost of construction varies not more than 20 to 25%, depending upon what product are you making or which city you are making in. You know, if I'm working in Ghaziabad, I could be selling for 3,000 rupees. And if I'm working in Mumbai and I'm selling for, say, 15,000 rupees in a suburban Mumbai at 15,000 rupees, 5 times differential, whereas my cost of construction differential might be only 25, 30, 40%. But the sale rate has become 500% differential, because it's the land which is creating the difference. Now, however, input credit is passed on, it would never be able to equate the differential which is happening because of extra 7.5%. So there will be an incidence of increased outflow from the pockets of the consumer of products above 5,000 rupees a square foot for sure. It is only below 5,000 rupees a square foot where there might be a near quid pro quo or a nominal increase in outflow from the consumer.
Okay. So, Anuj, this is a big concern that every developer has been raising, and you know, we had talked to other developers earlier and they were raising the same issue. This land element, it's a huge deal for developers. Why do you think the government has not thought about it?
That's a very good point, Anjali. But, you know, if I can just take a little rewind it to the previous point, I do know that a lot of developers sent out emails to the buyers to prepay. And I think that was more to improve their own cash flows, because I dare say that they could have calculated whether it is going to be an additional impact of tax on the buyer or not. So I think it was a good opportunity that the developers found. By trying to send in those emails, and you know, many buyers did prepay. I think on the land, there is certainly, I don't know whether it's a dichotomy or whether it's a misunderstanding. And you know, one of the examples that I'll give you, Anjali, is in Bombay in Bandra Kurla complex, where land is sold by MMRDA on lease to the developers. Now, there is an incidence of GST that is going to be applicable on that land when the developer is going to buy. And as per the GST, if the lease rental attracts GST, there is no credit that you are going to be able to secure on the input. So for a developer who is buying a property from MMRDA in BKC, he is paying the full GST, but there is no offset. Yes. That the developer is going to be allowed just because the land was taken on lease. And as per the GST law, there is no credit for leased income that is being given. So I do feel is those anomalies certainly pertaining to the land will need to be ironed out. Otherwise, you are going to start seeing a huge jump in the price of the property. And my concern is that who's going to bear this jump? If the developers believe that it is going to be the consumer, I dare say that the consumer is going to bear that jump, Anjali, because from a consumer's point of view, he or she is going to say, my price has gone up, whether it was the profit of the developer, whether it was the financing cost, whether it is the GST cost, I just don't have the money to pay that additional cost. And the developer is going to say, well, it is not really coming into my pocket.
Yes.
So I think that is going to be some situation that will need to, you know, a solution will need to get arisen, because it's not as simple that we are saying is that if there is any incidence of GST, we're going to simply pass it on to the consumer, because I think you're going to see a fair amount of resistance from the consumer who's anyway saying that the property prices are high, and then on top of it, you add on the incidence of GST. I don't think consumer is just going to be ready to accept that incidence.
Well, earlier we have seen that a lot of cost has been passed on to the consumers and they've not had a choice but to pay, whether it's been compensation cost or many other such costs. But Rajesh, would you like to comment on this as well? Because in my belief, let's say if your land cost is 40% of your entire project cost, then it becomes a problem for you. Or is it possible to offset that cost with the with the input credits that you get in the construction? Is it possible? I'm assuming you will say it's not, but you know, how challenging is it for you?
No, it is actually challenging, given especially in Mumbai, where you know 8,000 to 10,000 rupees is the normal cost of land here, and it's really difficult for me to comprehend how the input tax credit will be able to offset the cost.
If that is not possible, a section of your community is saying that maybe the GST should be lower, not 12%. Maybe a bit lower, especially on the on the sale of under construction property. Do you feel that would be a better solution? Maybe, because you know, we are assuming that the tax rolls out, but nothing is set in stone. As and when they'll see that what is required, changes could be made, amendments could be made. So, do you feel that?
What I feel is, when you compare it to this. This service tax and VAT era, the consumers are paying 5.5%, and if the authorities, the government feels that yes, 6% is good or 7% is good, and there is no input tax credit also available, then also it is fine. One fixed percentage, like it was 4.5% earlier, and plus 1%, so 5.5%. Instead of that, maybe 6% or 6.5% is also fine, but But one fixed percentage, if it comes to, then I don't think there should be any major issue for us, because the consumers will know what they are paying. There is no anomaly, there is no calculations to be done. Like earlier, it's just a fixed cost
but
for us.
My concern is that it's difficult to come to that fixed number. We are already, right now we are giving a fixed number and everybody has their reservations about it. Prashant, do you feel that it is possible to lower the GST and it will be more beneficial for the sector? Because right now a lot of people have a problem with the 12% taxation, because there are other things, you know, stamp duty has to be paid and there are other things which will get added on to it.
Right, very true. So, as late as yesterday night, so what the government has done is they come out with notifications notifying the rates. The rate, if you look at the notification, it says for a construction of complex, which is meant for sale, the rate is 18%. And then the explanation in that notification says, but from the value of the apartment or unit, deduct 1/3 value for land component, and that's how you arrive at your 12% rate. So that's how they've written out the notification. So effectively the government is then saying, listen, the rate on construction is 18, okay, but because land value is included, you get 1/3 deduction from the sale value of your apartment, and you effectively pay 18% on 67%, which effectively works out to 12%. And so the debate now is that 1/3 deduction for land enough? Because I think that's in my view and my experience, it's not even on the lower band. It actually doesn't cover the land costs that are actually paid by the developers. So I think that is abysmally low. So that is one, and that's where the problem arises, because it's not a 12% on the apartment. You still have a 6% and 7% stamp duty to be paid. So effectively, the consumer is paying close to 18 or 19%.
Absolutely.
And that's the tax cost in buying an apartment today. So that's on one side of our conversation. The second is reply to your question, Anjali. Yes, it is possible because it's a B2C segment. So most of the B2C segment, if you look at the notifications, be it like a Ola or a Rent-A-Cab or a Uber, they have a 5% rate. They're saying, forget all your credits, just pay 5% on your services and be done with it. Because the developer community, especially on the residential project, are in the B2C sector. So I think the point that is being made is, can't we just have a flat rate of 5%, which is available for, there's a 5% schedule as well, deny us the credit.
So I saw a lot of heads nodding the minute 5% was mentioned, you know, all of you were nodding your heads. Rohit, what do you feel about that 5% that has been thrown there by Prashant?
You know, it makes sense, because whether you keep that number as 5 or 6, because it land is not really 1/3 the way it has been assumed. Land is minimum 1/3 and goes all the way up to 75 to 80%, depending upon which city, which micro market you're working in. And from a government's revenue point of view as well, assume that the GST was only 6% on real estate and the input credit which the developer was getting was more, the overflow would have gone to the government. Government would be still getting the same revenue. Here, they have unnecessarily loaded the consumer with an additional burden because of the land component contributing to the sale value upwards of 50%. So if it's a 5 or a 6%, I think it would sort out the problem, because unlike any other product or service, we have a stamp duty to deal with of 5 to 7% as well.
Okay, so one thing is there, we've all sort of come to a consensus. Of course, I'm excluded from this, that 5 or 6% is a good number. But before we wrap up this debate, I need one point from you, and very short, like probably like a phrase or a sentence. What is the most important thing for you and for the government as GST rolls out? So starting with you, Anuj.
Clearly from my perspective, I think there needs to be a little bit more clarity on the incidence of GST for land. And I think once that gets sorted out, there is going to be a little bit more semblance in the way the real estate sector is going to understand implication of GST.
Right. Rajesh, what's your contribution? What do you say?
See, I mean, for us, for the developers, I think most of the developers will never want to take anything away from the pocket of our consumers. But at the same time, we do not wish to give, give away something from our pocket also. End of the day, it's our business, and we would like to see it grow. And any taxation should be simplified, should simplify our life and not complicate it. So I think that is my take on it.
Prashant, what about you?
So I've got two statements to make. One, subsume stamp duty into GST, and yes. Second, increase the land deduction that is given now, one-third. One-third should be minimum of 50% plus.
Yes, yes, very clear and crystal clear points. Rohit, is there anything left for you to say now?
Only two things, 100% land abatement and input credit for the entire period of construction, not only 12 months.
Great. So, thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining in this debate. We've been able to actually get a lot of clarity about GST, and especially from the consumer end also. Thank you so much. So, GST may be here, but its effects will show with time. So, it might be too early for me to say anything in my concluding remarks today. But if you go by the definition of a reform, it is to make changes in something, especially an institution or practice, in order to improve it. The operative word here for us is improve, and that's what we hope GST will do, without harming the interest of all the stakeholders, the developer, the buyer, and even the state. That's all we have for you in this GST debate. Thanks for watching. It's time for a short break now. When we come back, we take a look at the government's efforts to make the cities more livable.